It is now my privilege to introduce the Commanding General of Training and Doctrine Command, General David Perkins.
We'll see you. All right, technology is working for us. Well, first of all, Scott, thanks for your leadership and pulling this together. This is a great venue. I'll tell you, for those of us that are trying to drive change in the Army, because we can reach out to a very broad audience and get, as Scott said, we're gonna lay out, I'm gonna talk about our operating concept. A number of other leaders are gonna talk about strategies implementing that. We have a lot of folks from the operating force, but this is a great time to get feedback from the wide array of folks that are here. If you are a Bolick student, please raise your hand. Bolick students, we got any Bolick students? I guess they're in the overflow room, right, Scott? All right, okay, oh, there they are, okay. How about if you Captain's Career Course? Captain's Career Course, folks, okay, whoa, okay. Looks like you'll win the tug of war. Non-commissioned officers out there, non-commissioned officers, who? Warrant officers, so a lot of Department of the Army civilians out there. Special thanks for the former leaders of our Army that are here. Kind of like Scott said, as I look out there, what it reminds me of is a young officer walking down the hallway of my company area looking at the chain of command board on the bulletin board, and now you're here in real life. So thanks for not only being here, but for those of us that are still serving, showing us what it really means to be a soldier for life, and dedicating yourself to the United States Army and our nation. A great example for the young folks that are out there. Well, as I still remember with fond memories being here in Building 4 as the only armor officer in my infantry officer advanced course. So I'm used to being outnumbered. And so as I look out there with all the people poised with all these questions, I feel right at home as I was at the infantry course, people asking me what's up with tanks and things like that. Well, what I'd like to do is kind of start off or carry on from where I finished last year. As Scott said, last year at this time, and it's a great scheduling of this conference, maneuver conference, because it lets me as a TRADOC commander kind of lay out where we're going, the guidance the chief is giving us, and get feedback from you all. So the last time I was here, we were just about to publish the Army operating concept. And we published that in October of last year, the Army operating concept, fondly known as TRADOC pamphlet 525-3-1. And I don't know, does that mean I'm standing in the wrong place? That's my initial feedback. I asked for feedback, I just didn't mean electronic. And so now, so I think a lot of you are here, so I'm not going to go into a lot of the details of the content. I'll kind of remind you of that, but I'm going to tell you what we've done with it. You know, sort of what have we done, what have you done for me lately? All right. So I'm going to talk about sort of now operationalizing the Army operating concept. So we kind of rolled it out last year, got great feedback from you all. And now a lot has gone on. And hopefully throughout the week that you're here, you'll see the influence that the Army operating concept is having on the Army. If you go to the first slide. So when in a complex world, the title of our Army operating concept. And I think already, as you've heard some of the discussions both from Scott and General Milley, you've heard this focus on the term when. You've heard the term complexity a lot. You see how this is going to be driving change. You're going to see how when I talk about the strategies we're coming up with, and I think Steve Townsend follows me from 18th Airborne Corps, then Bob Brown and all those. If you denote a lack of logic flow, that is important as well. And so, you know, sometimes we drink the Kool-Aid so much as we work this stuff, we may not notice some discontinuities, feedback like that would be important. What I'd like to do is, again, point out some of the major tenets of this and remind folks as to the purpose of an operating concept. The purpose of an operating concept is to drive future force design, doctrine, organization, our whole .mil PF process in the Army. And what it does is it describes the Army's role in joint global operations, and it identifies first order capabilities that the United States Army needs to have to fulfill those roles. And from that drives all of our .mil PF solutions. Now, I have highlighted a couple, and I'll go on to the next page to get some more specifics on it, but there's a number of things that have jumped out that are really driving how we view the future with regards to the Army. When we say win in a complex world, when we say win, we're saying the tactical, operational, and strategic level. Because in the end, you win and lose at the strategic level. You must be dominant at the tactical and operational level, kind of like Scott said. You must be fast, precise, lethal, smart, et cetera. You always have to win those exchanges of firepower. But exchanges of firepower alone are not going to deliver the win at the strategic level. So we have to not only be proficient in synchronizing and delivering firepower, we as the United States Army have to be proficient at synchronizing and delivering national power. Because national power is what is going to allow us to win at the strategic level. So when you take a look at things like integrate partners, the foundation for joint operations, we're not saying the Army is always in the lead. We're not saying that we're more important than anybody else. But what we are saying is the unique nature of the domain that we operate in, the land domain, this is where these things occur. That is where the final act of compulsion takes place. In the other domains, you generally are trying to convince people to do things. And that's very useful. It's kind of like General Milley said on Iwo Jima. You had air power, you had naval power. They were trying to convince the Japanese either to give up or that all acts were futile, et cetera, like that. If you take a look at Saddam from Desert Storm on, we tried to convince him to give up power, to relinquish control, et cetera, like that. But it wasn't until with Saddam, until some soldiers from the 4th Infantry Division and Special Operation Forces yanked his butt out of a hole in the ground and said, on behalf of the United States of America, I compel you to give up power. I compel you to come with me. Because to compel somebody means in the absence of voluntary compliance, where you're trying to convince somebody to do something, in the end, it involves a level of voluntary compliance. If I'm bombing you from the air over and over and over again, eventually, we hope that you will voluntarily comply. And sometimes people do, and that's great. And I've pushed and talked and tried to get a lot of convincing throughout my life. And sometimes it works, and sometimes it enables us to compel. But what you do on land is you compel activity. That's why you have an army, to be the ultimate force of compulsion, absence voluntary compliance. And to do that, that occurs on land, and you have to be able to integrate partners. You heard General Milley talk about it. Not only the joint force, coalition partners, interagency partners, all the other folks that come together. And that generally occurs on land. Therefore, when you look at a dot-mil PF solution to the future of the Army, training a leader development, you've got to figure out how do we train and develop our leaders so they are very comfortable with all of the people that are going to show up to the fight. The Marines, the Navy, UNHCR, Special Operations Forces, cyber, maritime, coalition forces at all echelons. Bob Brown's going to talk about our human dimension strategy. That has a lot to do with it. It is a very, quite honestly, a pretty significant task to kind of throw that in your rucksack that you're expecting the United States Army to do that because you tend to be the foundation upon which we bring all these other enablers together. When we talk about complex world, we're talking about a world that is unknown and constantly changes. Constantly changing. So how do you organize yourself to deal with a world that constantly changes? As Scott said, task organized for purpose, and that purpose could constantly change day in and day out. How do you mentally prepare people to be able to deal with constant unknown? One of the comparisons I make is that as a young armor officer in the early 80s show up to Germany, where all good armor officers ended up, and you're on the inter-German border, they said, hey, Perkins, here's your general defense plan location. Take your 5 M60 non-rise, non-passive tanks, and you're going to dig them in here. This is 1,500 meters, and this is it. And you're going to sit here, and Echelon 1 comes, you kill them. Echelon 2 comes, you kill them, et cetera. And then what you're going to do is every 90 days, you're going to go to the GDP, and you're going to borrow the XO's Jeep, and you're going to recon it, and you're going to drive the routes and figure out how long it takes, and are there new high-tension wires you have to drop so you can fire TOW missiles and have lunch with the Germans on your left, have dinner with the Brits on your right, get to know them. Here's the bio of your Soviet leader you're going to attack or that you're going to fight. And so what they're saying is, Perkins, here's where you're going. When the big one goes up, you're going here. That's it. These are your 1,500 meters. I want you to continue to learn more and more about this. Every quarter, you go to the GDP, you recon it, you have your battle book, and you have your acetate maps, and you put all the little markings on, et cetera. And when the balloon goes up, you execute these road march tables, et cetera, like that. The difference now is that when we talk to Lieutenant Perkins, and there is a Lieutenant Perkins out there in the Army, we say, hey, you know, I don't know where you're going. I can't give you a 1,500-meter swath where you're going, and I don't know who's going to be on your coalition. I don't know what the ROE is going to be. I don't know who the enemy is. I don't know if you're going to go to the Baltics. I don't know if you're going to go to Korea. I don't know if you're going to go to the Mideast. And the situation will probably constantly change, but I do know one thing, Perkins. You're not going to go there and recon it every quarter. In fact, probably the first time you'll ever see that place is when you show up to fight. And you're not going to be having partnership activities with coalition members. The first time you meet them may be at the line of departure. So how do you develop people like that? That's come to grips with the complexity that we're operating in. And so when we talk about winning a complex world, it really is helping define what we're going to do .milpf. You heard General Milley talk about it. One of the things that we have to do to win at the strategic level is present multiple dilemmas to the enemy. We cannot be a one-trick pony. We have to have multiple dilemmas, because if you can provide multiple dilemmas, what you do is that's when you start to put the enemy into a strategic conundrum. Because what you're saying is, wherever you move, enemy, I've got something for you, because I'm integrating all of my partners, economic activity, political activity, the joint force, the coalition partners. And what I'm trying to do to my enemy is raise his strategic risk calculation to a point, hopefully, where they are unwilling to take that risk. That is the key aspect of deterrence, that as you do that risk calculation, you have so many dilemmas you can present your enemy, is that they cannot mitigate them all sufficiently, and it deters them from action. If they think you only have one or two dilemmas you can present them, then they can figure out how to fix and bypass that. Then it tends to invite adventurism. So we're saying, and generally, land power is the one that can synchronize and coordinate and provide those multiple dilemmas to our adversaries that are making that risk calculation about whether they want to be adventurous or not. So then that means when we design the Army, do we design formations? Do we buy equipment? Do we train and develop leaders such that they have multiple capabilities, they understand the operating environment, and they can provide multiple dilemmas to the adversary out there? Things like that are actually very useful. I'm going to talk about how they become very useful as we start designing the future of the Army and our .milpf solutions to them. Next slide. And so here are some tenets and core competencies, and I'll just highlight a couple. Previously, under Unified Land Operations, we said the Army had two core competencies: combined arms maneuver, which we define as the application of all elements of combat power to get to a position of relative advantage. You've heard both Scott Miller and the Chief of Staff of the Army always talk about this: get to a position of relative advantage. No matter what the situation is, get to a position of relative advantage, a position of tactical, operational, and strategic advantage, provide a series of dilemmas to the enemy so that they are in a position of disadvantage. And then wide area security, which is applying all elements of combat power to prevent the enemy from them getting in a position of advantage compared to us. But as we formalize Army operating concept, we added a number of other ones here. And again, this is our focus here was not for this to be a parochial document. In fact, if you looked at the last slide, we adequately covered the role of the Marines, the Navy, the Air Force, et cetera. So it's not to be overly parochial, but I say it, one of the purposes is to be adequately parochial. In other words, we need to adequately describe what land power does so we don't assume away the complexity of land power, which is a very difficult place to operate in. One of them is we have special operations here. And some people say, well, that's kind of interesting, is in that sort of Joe Votel's realm. Well, I've talked to Joe Votel, and I think the last figure he gave me that 80% of all of the capability in his command is United States Army on it. So if you don't have an Army, you don't have a special operations capability. A huge portion of his logistics, his network, his special operators, on and on and on, come from the United States Army. So the United States Army provides 80% of capability, you'll hear me talk about capability quite a bit, to the special operating force. So again, When people say, well, the future of the world is you're never going to have, you don't need a large land force because you're not going to do large scale activity, et cetera, like that. Well, that's a whole other discussion. But they say, all we need is special operators. Well, if all you need is special operators, then you really need the United States Army, because 80% of the capacity of special operations comes from the United States Army. Shape the security environment. Very critical on what we do that, building coalition capacity, building coalition relationships, pays off both immediate and long-term. Set the theater. The United States Army provides the majority of the network to the Navy in the Pacific. If you talk to our friends in the Pacific, people tend not to think of that as a land combatant command. You talk to the folks out there, if you did not have the Army, you would not have the integral pieces for that theater to operate. Project national power. As I said, what we do as a land force is we synchronize and deliver national power, of which firepower is a part of it. A couple of other things I'd like to point out here is emphasizes the human aspect of war. And again, Bob Brown's going to talk about with the human dimension. And this is a unique aspect, and it gets back to that convince versus compel analogy between what happens in the various domains. If you are, and again, we are integral to the joint force. The United States Army cannot do any of its missions without a joint capability, but there's an inherent difference with regards to the land domain as compared to the other domains. If you take a look at the air domain, the sea domain, you cannot be in those domains unless you are in a thing, okay? You cannot be at 30,000 feet unless you are in something. Okay, you have to be surrounded by technology to be at 30,000 feet. You cannot be at 500 miles offshore unless you are in a thing, okay, unless you can tread water very well. So that's physics. That's how those domains work. You have to be in something. You have to be surrounded by a piece of technology to even exist in that domain. But you can be in the land domain and not be in anything. In fact, the majority of the world exists in the land domain, not surrounded by any technology, not in anything. So because of that, when you look at the other domains, the people that operate primarily that domain are focused on buying things to fight other things, okay? Because that's what happens in those domains. There are things in them, and those things fight each other. So what the people that operate in those domains do is they focus on buying things to fight. In the land domain, what we are focused on is building capability to win. And you're going to hear that. You heard it from Scott Miller. You heard it from the chief. The word capability. Capability is different than a thing, okay? And we're not buying things to fight because we don't want to just fight. We want to win. So that means the United States Army has to build capability to win at all echelons of war. Part of that capability, a huge part of it, is a human aspect of that. As I said already, consider all echelons of war. You don't show up to war and say, well, we're going to do the tactical part from 8 to 9, then the operational part will be from 11 to 12, and the strategic. It happens all simultaneously. That's why we talk about winning a complex world. You have to operate simultaneously through all echelons of war, and you've got to train and develop your leaders to be able to do that. I already talked about the criticality of land forces. And then the integration of technologies. This is not to say anti-technology. In fact, I'm going to talk about technologies we're going after. But it's not technology for technology's sake. It's not just technologies to have a thing. It's technologies combined with soldiers in formations to build a capability to win, a dot MIL-PF solution to it, not just a thing. And so the way we're looking at it, you're going to see, is we want a strategy to build a capability, not a plan to buy a thing. Because when you come up with plans to buy things, we haven't always done well at that because we weren't able to integrate it with regards to a strategy to build a capability. Next slide. So what does the role of the Army operating concept? Well, the Army operating concept is right here. You can see, as I said already, it identifies the first order capabilities, not things. Capabilities to accomplish our mission. If you read through the Army operating concept, it doesn't say anything about what the next helicopter or tank or something like that. It doesn't just say what it is. What it does is it describes the capability of our formations. And then what we do after that is we then drive our functional concepts of which they are being produced right now. And you can, and Scott already talked about the movement and maneuver one. So these are coming out right now. So we have all of our functional concepts, which are being driven by the Army operating concept. So then it drives all the functional concepts, of which then to solve the capability requirements in here, we come up with dot mil PF solutions. Next slide. And so we are now producing all of these functional concepts in line with our operating concept. And then we have supporting strategies and white paper. In fact, as I said, Bob Brown's going to come up, talk about the human dimension strategy, Army leader development strategies. I'm going to talk a little bit about the combat vehicle modernization strategy. So you can see what these are. These are strategies to build capabilities as required by functional concepts so that we can win in a complex world. So that's the power of this, is to start driving this whole process here. So the Army operating concept does not discuss how many men in an infantry squad. It doesn't list out the POM, what we're gonna buy. What it describes are the first order capabilities you saw on that map there, multiple dilemmas, multiple options, and multiple domains, integrate partners, deliver aspects of national power, et cetera, like that. Have these functional concepts to get a little bit more into the how, and then supporting strategies to do that. And they are all being produced as we talk, which is why these conferences are so powerful for us, so we can inform the great audience out there, and we get feedback if you think there's any discontinuities. Next slide. So here is one of the things that we are spending a lot of time on, and it really is changing the way we're doing business. As I said, we want to avoid coming up with plans to buy things and develop strategy to build capability. And you're all very familiar, even if you're not a CMS graduate, that we have strategies outlined as ends, ways, means. And so we talked about the end state here, these first order capabilities that are outlined in the Army operating concept and our functional concept. I'm going to talk about the ways in a minute here that we're going to get to the ends. And of course, you have the means going on here with regards to resources and funding and all that. But here is one of the changes. I'm going to talk through the process that we do that. So when I showed up to this job and would go to meetings in TRADOC and visit my good friends in the Pentagon and work through all that, what I found is that I was going to meetings and we were having discussions and we had kind of lost track of how this is supposed to work. That you have an end state that you've articulated, capability to win, and then you have various ways, I'm going to talk about that, and then you talk through those ways, and then you take a look at the means and determine which ways are feasible. But this really shouldn't change that often if you have it right. The problem is, we kind of got 11 worth redo. Instead of spending all our time talking about ways to get ends, I would go to meetings and we spend most time talking about ways to get means. Okay, we were kind of going backwards. It was a way to get means. How do I get money, various things like that, palm wedge, et cetera, like that. And we had lost sight that we've got to link this to this. And the problem is, if you spend all your time about ways to get means, when you get means, and we would get means, you couldn't link them together coherently to provide a capability, and therefore you didn't get an end state. And that was presenting us with a problem. Both the problem is we articulated what capability that we wanted when we talked to our friends in OSD and Congress, et cetera, like that, as well as internally to the Army, like, where are we going with this? And therefore, when we come up short on means, what we would do is then we would just readjust ways to better get means, and we would really not get the ends we want. I can go into long discussion about various cancellations of programs and things like that, but that was part of, I think, the manifestation of that. So what we've done, and you can see when I laid out the Army operating concept, is now we have strategies for combat vehicle modernization, network strategies, autonomous robotic and autonomous strategies. What are the ends we want? So as we look, and we have various ways, because these are going to change a lot. Sequestration, Budget Control Act, et cetera, like that. So as these change, we want to have a long list of ways so we can still keep our focus on here. So next slide. One of the things we have done to do that is we say, look, we want to focus on first order capabilities. So in the Army operating concept, we lay out Army warfighting challenges. You can see these are not things, these are capabilities. These are capabilities. So we pick 20 so that we can do 5 per quarter. And what we do is we bring together a very collaborative group of folks. When you looked at our tenets for the Army Operating Concept, you saw innovation is one of the tenets. So if you study much about the science of innovation, one of the things that drives innovation is a wide swath of collaboration, a lot of collaboration. So whether it's the generating force, the operating force, the folks that run the budgeting, all the people that have a play in it, we bring them together, and every quarter we focus on 5 warfighting challenges. And so you can see these are capabilities, whether it's develop situational understanding, conduct entry operations. I think Steve Townsend is going to talk about that. In fact, last quarter, that is one that we did. Okay, entry operations. That's a capability the Army has to have. So who came down to TRADOC headquarters to discuss that? So we had Jeff Smith, Steve's deputy commander, commanding general of the 82nd Airborne Division. I said, I'm not sure the last time we had the commander of the 82nd Airborne Division in TRADOC headquarters kind of telling the TRADOC staff what capabilities we wanted, but it was very powerful. And then we had Tom Vandal on from Career talking about counter WMD. We had asymmetric warfare group there. We had folks on from Army G3, from the G8 shop, from Fort Benning, okay, Fort Sill, Fort Rucker. And we said, look, here's a capability the Army needs. How do we get at this? And it's cross-cutting. It is. You notice as we set these capabilities up, they are not by warfighting function, okay? They are not by the stovepipes of warfighting functions. They are not by pegs, okay, in the POM. They are cross-cutting, saying this is a capability the Army needs. And what we found out as we started going through these is you then have these subordinate capabilities. You say, you know what? This is necessary to, back when Tom Vandal was talking about his requirements in 2ID and Korea, it's like, you know, I have WMD. We don't have enough experts. If I had reach-back capability with soldiers going subterranean, they could get back to Fort Leavenworth with the chemical folks. They could do this. And then 18th Airborne Corps said, you know what? When I deploy forward, I have a small footprint. One of the things I really need is reach-back, so that I can have a smaller footprint, be more deployable, et cetera, like that. Talking to the MedCom folks, MedCom says, you know what? When we go forward, when we have casualties, et cetera, like that, if we can have sort of distance medicine plugged in with reach back, et cetera. So this whole term of reach back's coming up saying, you know what? If we can have is what we call home station as a docking station, and we really build our facilities back here so that we can get reach back, whether folks are doing WMD, medical activity, entry operations, et cetera, it solves a lot of our problems. And so what's happening, when we don't get consumed by warfighting function, pegs, POM slices, et cetera, that, when we back up and say, look, I'm not interested in buying things, I'm interested in a strategy to build a capability, now you start seeing some common denominators out there. Then the challenge is, but the problem is, folks say, but that's not how we buy stuff. We do buy stuff in pegs and POMs, et cetera, like that. So how are you going to take all these great ideas and capabilities? Because you're building round pegs, and the system is a series of square holes. So now what we have to do is go back and take a look at the process and say, I'm building round pegs. Maybe we need to change these square holes into round holes. And that's where this whole process of collaboration is key. Next slide. And so we have a series of ways that we're going after that. And so one of them, you saw under the ways, is we are going to do warfighting challenges, determine those first order capabilities. And then we are going to experiment and have war games, then to test and validate those, okay? So one of them is the Army warfighting assessment. This is kind of like the NIE after next. NIE basically is an experiment with all the statutory and regulatory aspects that come with it for the network. This is Army Warfighting Assessment, which is really our way to innovate concepts, doctrine, organizations, et cetera, and not be constrained by the methodologies required by testing, et cetera, like that. It takes place out at Fort Bliss. We're really kind of our proof of principle will be this fall. It is going to be multinational. We have the Brits coming, and they are going to actually be in Stryker vehicles. They're bringing a lot of their kit, putting them in U.S. Army Stryker vehicles to take a look at interoperability. We have the Italians playing distributed from Italy are playing in this exercise. We have Marines, we have Air Force, we have interagency folks. And what we are going to do is work through a series of concepts, operational concepts, organizational concepts, training, leader development, and materiel, and generate some first order observations based on these capabilities that have come out of our warfighting challenges. And so then this is boots in the dirt. We'll do this every year. And the next slide. And then we have our annual unified quest, which is the Chief's War Game. And this is getting after really taking a look at the future. What are our threats, enemies, adversaries? How are they going to operate? What are our concepts, et cetera, like that? So we have the warfighting challenges, which are looking after our capabilities to win, cross warfighting function, cross pigs, palm bills, et cetera, like that. We have the Army warfighting assessment, which is boots in the dirt, kind of confirming or denying that this works. And then we have the annual war game that the chief directs, and we have our goals out of that. And then what we do is we take all of those things, next slide, and we start looking at the process on how we make decisions and allocate resources in the Army. As I said, the way that we had laid out with warfighting challenges, with capabilities versus things, non-peg, et cetera, like that, those are round pegs. And as long as you know, spend time up in the building processes is a series of square holes. They want input by warfighting function. They want input by pegs. And, you know, it's a very long process, and, you know, it drives itself, and it's in concert with OSD and Congress. So we know we can't change all of that overnight. But what we've done is we've put together a governance process really to drive that process. As we sat down with the chief and the secretary, we laid out the whole acquisition process, our modernization process, and said, you know, there's a lot of things in here that need to be changed. There's a lot of things we have to update, but you're not going to do it overnight. There are a lot of equities in there. But instead of immediately trying to change the whole process, let's see if we can drive the process. As I tell my folks all the time, I'm not really interested in owning the process. What I'm interested in is owning the idea to drive the process. If you own the ideas to drive the process, then that means sometimes you don't have to get bogged out in the day-to-day aspects of it. So what we've done is established this that kind of lays on top of the whole POM build, et cetera, like that. And you start out here with the board of directors, which is really just four people, the secretary, the chief, the under, and the vice, and I'm the executive secretary for agenda, in other words, sort of tee up the topics. And what this does is it allows the very senior leaders of the Army the ability to put their fingerprint and prioritization on those big first-order capabilities that we want in the Army. Because a lot of the frustration with the chief and the secretary previously is by the time all the folks down in the salt mines grind through everything, and by the time it gets up to them, it's almost too late for them to really adequately influence it. They can veto it, but they wanted a way to early on drive it. So what this lets them do is exactly that. And part of our job, as we run through this with steering committees and executive committees, is tee up those big decisions. That once you make those big decisions, you're going to drive 1,000 other things. And things such as, like, do we want cross-portfolio trades? Do we move resources between pegs? Do we say this is a priority now and this is not a priority and adjust resources like that? Do we set marks on the wall with regards to what is our capability requirement, and then everything becomes subordinate to that? And what this has allowed us to do, and then once they make the decision, the executive committee is chaired by myself with all the other four stars, ACOM commanders, and you can see down at the three-star level, we then can start executing their desires and their priorities and drive the system. Now, we're working on changing it, you know, bit by bit, but this now allows them to drive the system. And I'll kind of lay out some, if you want to call it short-term wins, things that we have come up that this process is allowing us now to drive it with those big first-order capability requirements and decisions. Next slide. So, in review here, what we do is we develop our concepts and requirements. So that's what the Army operating concept does. First-order requirements identifies the Army's role in the global joint force. Then we have the functional concepts that are coming out now. Take a look at those. And we have the warfighting challenges. I said we do five per quarter. So you can see there's 20 of them. I'm sure you didn't memorize which each one was. But this lists out per quarter which warfighting challenges we're going to work on. And then we take what comes out of the warfighting challenges and we run them through either Unified Quest War Game, Army warfighting assessment, et cetera, come up with our evaluations, and then we run them through that governance program. You saw with the board of directors, steering committee, et cetera. So it's being driven by these first order capabilities, kind of refined with our warfighting challenges, validated down here, and then it gets driven by the board of directors, the big decisions, and it constantly moves. In other words, one of the things we're trying to do is increase the rate of innovation. increase the rate of innovation. The Army has to innovate quicker. We have to identify problems quicker. We have to solve problems quicker. We have to get everybody on the same sheet of music quicker. And that's one of the big roles of the Army operating concept. So hopefully, as I said, you hear people talking here today, they're using the same terms. Position of relative advantage, rate of innovation, winning, complexity, et cetera, like that, driving a common visualization. So when you come up with a human dimension strategy, when you come up with a combat vehicle modernization strategy, your strategy is in line with the end state capability that the Army is driving for. So let me tell you about a couple examples here. Next slide. So combat vehicle modernization strategy, okay, not a plan to buy a tank. And I know that's hard for me to say as a former armor officer, but the combat vehicle modernization strategy is not a plan to buy a tank, it's a strategy to build a capability for the Army, okay? And what do we want? We want the ability to have this combination of lethality, mobility, and protection, a capability for a formation to be mobile, have a level of protection, and be lethal. So when you talk about fast, lethal, etc. like that, you're seeing these capabilities, you're seeing this thread of logic drive through this whole thing. So how do you look at a formation and provide it with lethality, mobility, and protection? Not a vehicle, a formation, a capability. And then what we do is we take a look at where is our risk right now with a combination of mobility, lethality, and protection, and where do we take a look at our investment priorities? I'm going to talk about how this strategy, based on the capability, eventually we have to have plans, and I'll lay out what the plan is. And one of the ways that we're approaching this is, say, the acronym here, SIDRA. We are going to sustain some capability on combat vehicle modernization. We are going to improve others. We're going to develop new stuff. We're going to replace something we have and continually assess it. So we're going to develop a strategy to provide mobility, lethality, and protection. And then we're going to take a look at our capability and apply this acronym of what do we want to sustain, improve, develop, replace, and assess. So next slide. So what we did, we're looking at a formation because the Army fights formations. We don't just fight a tank. That's the problem when you focus on buying things to fight. You assume that thing is going to fight all by itself. And what happens when you do that is you lose control of requirements. Because you say, well, I'm going to put this thing, a tank, in the middle of the desert. It needs to be impervious to all new munitions. It's got to fly. It's got to be do this, et cetera, like that. And you're like, but that's hopefully not how we fight it. We're not going to put a tank all by itself in the desert. It's going to be part of a formation. A formation which has a total capability to be mobile, a total capability to provide protection, and total capability of lethality. So we've taken each of our major action figures here, infantry brigade combat team, striker brigade combat team, and armor brigade combat team, and we divide it into the means. The end state is a combination, is the ability to be to get to a position of relative advantage. We do that by combining mobility, protection, lethality. A tank is a way to do that. A tank is not an end state. A tank is a way to combine mobility, protection, lethality, but there are other ways to do it. Maybe the lethality portion is autonomous to the vehicle, okay? Maybe the protection aspect of it is in combination with regards to capability in the formation. Maybe it's active protection, et cetera, like that. So these aren't capabilities of the thing. They are capabilities of a formation to win. So we said, let's take a look at our three action figures here, mobility, protection, lethality, and take a look at where we have, I said, our near-term risk. And what we've determined is that the place that we are least capable as a formation with a capability, not a thing, is mobility of our light forces, okay? Our light forces have the mobility of a World War I formation, okay? Our light forces, our most deployable forces, can strategically deploy anywhere in the world very quickly just in time to reenact World War I by moving at 2.5 miles per hour and carrying machine guns. Now, Steve, I know they're much more capable of that, but for dramatic effect. So what we're saying is we sort of want some of these first order, you know, I'm a first order principle kind of guy. So one of the principles is, you know, I think it's hard to argue, that when we send soldiers into combat, our soldiers should be as mobile as the enemy. I mean, who would argue and say, no, we need to be slower than the enemy. No, because that's not going to put us in a position of relative advantage. See the power of having first order capability? You need to be in a position of relative advantage and provide multiple dilemmas to the enemy. Well, if the enemy can move at 30 miles per hour and you can move at 2 miles per hour, that's not much of a dilemma. And it's definitely not going to put you in a position of advantage. So we've determined by the main effort sign here that the number one priority for the combat vehicle modernization strategy from a former armor officer who's in charge of TRADOC is mobility for the light forces. Why? Because we have a strategy to provide a capability to the United States Army to be in a position of relative advantage across the full range of military operations. So our number one priority, I think Steve's going to talk about it, is mobility for the light forces. See the power of having a strategy based on capabilities versus a plan to buy a thing. What's another near-term capability? If you take a look at the strikers, our lethality. We have now strikers in Europe that are trying to deter Russian adventurism. They're manned, again, with a World War I weapon, a machine gun. So we're saying we have inadequate lethality in our striker formation. So what's another near-term priority for us? Increasing lethality of this formation. Okay, not necessarily a new vehicle, but increasing lethality, upgunning this formation. Probably our most capable formation with regards to capabilities are these guys right here. So you notice our near-term priorities are not necessarily down here with regards to this, replacing some of our obsolete vehicles, but we have much greater demands up here with regards to this capability. So next slide, how does this lay out with regards to now plans? So eventually we do have a plan, but it's based not on a plan to buy something, but on a strategy to build a capability. We then lay out SIDRA, sustain, improve, develop, replace, assess, as I said, by formation, near, mid, and term. This now allows us to apply resources, say, well, the near-term requirement is this, and talked about already, is to improve mobility for the near-term, for the our light forces, improve lethality in the near-term for strikers, et cetera, like that. For this force here, in the near term, we want to improve sustainability, okay? We want to reduce our logistical load. In other words, our heavy formations are pretty good right now with regards to position of relative advantage. Their weak link is they have a very large tail with them. So when you take a look at the U.S. Army trying to be expeditionary, that's our problem with these guys. It's not necessarily lethality, it is sustainability. So when you look at a combat vehicle modernization strategy for these guys, it's about reducing the tail. For these guys, it's about being mobile. For these guys, it's about being lethal. And then you can start laying things out. Then you can start prioritizing resources. Then you can start moving resources around because everyone's on the same sheet of music because we have a common vision of what the end state is. And if resources change, these priorities shouldn't change. You may be able to do it less fast, scale, et cetera, like that, but we shouldn't change the end state too much. You just come up with a different way to execute the strategy. Next slide. So that's combat vehicle modernization. So that's an example how the Army operating concept through the functional concepts and then that new governance process we have changes, for instance, in this case, that's just one example, how we are looking at our combat vehicles in the future. Not a plan to buy things, a strategy to build a capability to win. Let's take a look at force design principles. With the Army operating concept, I said one of the requirements is to denote first order capability, develop first order principles when you start designing the force. Don't have a preconceived notion, I want the force to look like this, and then sort of reverse engineer the reason why it looks like that. So as we are redesigning the Army, you know that recently we announced active forces going to 450, so we're re-looking how we do that, what are options, et cetera, like that. We said before we go there, we ought to come up, what are the principles? What is it we want our Army formations to do and define them? So we talk about expeditionary, but we kind of define it because people use that term very loosely. And what we're saying, expeditionary is different than deployable. Deployable means I can get there. I can get there. It doesn't really denote any capability once you get there. What we're saying to be expeditionary, you have to be able to get there as well as transition immediately upon arrival and conduct sustained operations. Why? Because we said that is one of the core competencies of the United States Army. One of the tenets of our Army operating concept is endurance, okay? Our joint force has a lot of exquisite boutique capability that can get to a lot of places in the world quickly. I tell folks, the United States Army, we are not a boutique force, okay? We are not some exquisite little force. We are the iron fist of the national defense. So we are not a boutique force. Our military has great boutique forces. We have sub-boutique forces in the Army, and that's great. But when you take a look at the United States Army, what we are, like I said in the beginning, we are the ultimate force of compulsion for our nation. We can compel any activity, anywhere, for any length of endurance. And this starts to separate the Army from some of the other boutique forces out there, is that we should have endurance necessary to win at the strategic level. So when you talk about expeditionary, it's not just getting there, it's getting there with adequate capability to transition rapidly to offensive operations. Because if you cannot transition rapidly to offensive operations, you are in a position of disadvantage, and you're not providing a dilemma to the enemy. In fact, you are presenting a target. You know, in AOC, we don't say present multiple targets to the enemy. We're saying present multiple dilemmas to the enemy. So if you deploy someplace and you can't move, we call that a target. Okay, if you can get someplace and you have a combination of mobility, lethality, and protection, that's now a dilemma to the enemy. So we're very clear when we focus on expeditionary versus deployability, because you've got to have the whole thing. You've got to have capability as well as endurance, because if the enemy knows they can wait you out or they can cut off your supply lines, you're shortly going to become a target. You're no longer a dilemma. Interoperability. You saw that picture I had. Can we interoperate with our coalition partners, joint force, et cetera, like that, interagency folks? Because, why? We already said we are going to be the foundation of the joint force and the ability to synchronize and deliver all elements of national power. So what kind of network do we buy? Huge question. In fact, we're bringing together all the senior leaders in the Army in a couple weeks out of Fort Leavenworth to figure this out. What is interoperability? What level of interoperability? It's probably not everybody all the time, but it probably is something that we can determine, and we need to define it. Agility. You can see agility is across the full range of military operations, not a boutique force. We're not a boutique force. Full range of military operations, and always be able to operate in domain to get to a position of relative advantage. You see this common lexicon up there. That's the power of an operating concept. First order capabilities, always in a position of advantage. Is this organization building, is it ever going to be disadvantageous to us? If it is, we probably need to figure out a .MIL-PF solution to it. So again, very clear on our principles for designing the Army. We need to always be able to get to a position of relative advantage against a full range of military operations, which probably means you need to be pretty interoperable, means you need a level of endurance to be able to transition quickly to operations. Next slide. And then overmatch, you heard the Chief talk about it, you heard Scott talk about it. So we talk about overmatch, again, multiple dilemmas. That's how you provide multiple dilemmas. No matter what the enemy can throw at us, I can provide overmatch. Maybe it's cognitive overmatch, okay? Maybe it's an overmatch of agility. I can react to conditions faster than the enemy can. Maybe it is a lethal overmatch. Maybe it is a protection overmatch. The enemy cannot penetrate whatever protection capability I have there. Stamina, sufficient operational depth to provide, again, multiple dilemmas across multiple domains. In other words, we ensure freedom of our movement, and we can execute a high tempo of operations over extended lines of communication. If you take a look at anywhere in the world, our plan is not to do a home game. So you need to say, you know what? We are going to operate over extended lines of communication. Lines of communication with regards to logistics. Lines of communication with regards to the network. So how do you do that over extended lines? In a very austere environment, so that you have the adequate agility to always present multiple dilemmas to the enemy. And again, versatility, full range of military operations. So again, we're still working these. You can see these are draft, but this is the thinking we're having. We're going to have a session with the Chief and the senior leaders here in a couple weeks, and next week. And we're going to talk about these design criteria. So you can see it doesn't say, well, how many men in the infantry squad, you know, how many tanks in the platoon, et cetera, like that. We'll eventually get there, but we want these first order principles to say, is that going to make me more agile or less agile? Is that going to allow me to operate over extended lines of communication or not? Because if you don't have these first order principles, what happens is you start to focus on buying things to fight versus building capability to win. And let me just check here and see. Okay, what I'd like to do now is just pause momentarily. I got the shot clock going on here. And take any questions, insights, recommendations, write our homework, because we haven't finalized first order capabilities. We're still working on functional concepts. Now's the time. I think I'll be followed by Steve Townsend, who's going to talk about some of the strategies with regards to this, Bob Brown, et cetera, like that. So thoughts. A Bolick lieutenant. Where is a Bolick lieutenant? Somebody's got to have a great idea up there. Because this is the army you'll execute, okay? When we finally put this thing out for print, this will be the army you execute. Somebody's got to have a question. Be anything. Nobody's going to ask me about gender integration? How's your chance, folks? Sir.
Sir, good morning. Cam Watson. I'm here with CGSOC WinSec.
Okay, WinSec guy? Okay.
We're here in the back, sir. Sir, you mentioned force design principles, specifically on the versatility. I believe that the way we are operating from the leader development program, it's somewhat rigid and outdated. I'm wondering how we're going to implement this in grooming future leadership for the Army and for joint and combined and gym environment in order to determine how we become that dilemma for the enemy, sir.
Yeah, that's a great point. In fact, we put out a leader development strategy. I don't know, Bobby, you can talk about the OPMS thing? Yeah. Okay, so I'm not going to steal too much of General Brown's thunder here. He's got the human dimension strategy, a strategy to build the capability for the kind of leaders we want. But I will tell you, as we take a look back at recent things we have done, when you go out to Command General Staff College, in all of the seminars, you have joint officers, you have international officers, you have interagency folks, et cetera. We've expanded greatly our fellowships with regards to other interagency kind of things that we do with our folks at a younger and younger age. But we are working very hard, not only on those kind of things, but on our POI, PME, to really, at all levels, develop folks that have the ability to be adaptive, innovative, critical thinkers, et cetera, look at things from a larger perspective. And we actually have a strategy to lay that out. There's a couple of things that become self-limiting, timelines, et cetera, like that. And General Brown is going to lay those out in detail. So I'll tell you, that is not a rock we have not overturned. We think there's huge potential in it. We're working with OSD. There's actually proposals to go back to Congress with some DOTMA kind of changes and things like that. So there's nothing that's off the table with regards to that. What we don't want to do is throw the baby out with the bathwater. So we also have to make sure that we're absolutely grounded in the fundamentals. If you're an infantry officer or armor officer or non-commissioned officer or anything, you have to be absolutely grounded in those fundamentals. But then we also have to broaden the aperture, mainly so that you see things within the larger context. But I think actually be a great foray into what General Brown's going to talk about, because there's a lot of exciting things out there that I think address specifically what we have identified as the same problem that you highlight. Sir.
I enjoyed your presentation, and I think I understand it. With the business of capabilities and ensuring compliance, understand in warfare, we do that by deploying armed forces. And then we deter by demonstrating capability prior to conflict. But cyber warfare or cyber operations are a lot more pervasive. So how does this fit in to what we're thinking about in the future, both from offensive and defensive operations? Because it's pervasive and it continues whether there's warfare declared or not declared.
Sir, I think it's a great point. Could you go back to the tenets and core competencies of the Army? I think it was like my second chart. Cyber is one that we paid a significant amount of attention to, and you can see, very, very interesting, we said cyber is a core competency of the Army. And a lot of people kind of question that first, really, of the Army? Cyber is a core competency of the Army? Well, we recently stood up the Cyber Center of Excellence down at Fort Gordon, formerly the Signal Center of Excellence, now the Cyber Center of Excellence, and it's a new branch. This year we stood up Cyber is now a branch. Our newest branch, I think, since SOF was our last new branch we stood up. So we don't do that often. The reason we did this, sir, is almost from the same reason, the exact reason you said, is cyber is pervasive all of the time. So when we say set the theater, part of setting the theater is the ability, even now, prior to conflict, to conduct cyber operations. But also, when you look at the other domains and some of the other people working in cyber, they tend to focus at the strategic level of cyber. Cybercom and others, rightly so, focusing at the strategic level of cyber. What we found as we looked at that domain of which cyber is, that there weren't a lot of people looking at the tactical and maybe operational level, and that's the level that we operated day in, day out. And we think there is huge potential to get to a position of relative advantage, especially the tactical level, and maybe actually not get caught up with some of the challenges that are involved at the strategic level with authorities and regulations, et cetera, like that, and that it is a little bit more local and contained. So we put this down there. In fact, is Ed Cardone coming here, Scott, to talk this week at all? I don't know. Ed Cardone, our cyber guy. And we've put our cyber teams together. The Army is really leading the way in this. I mean, like most things, we don't tend to maybe toot our horn a lot and just kind of get on with our nation's business. But what's going on down at Fort Gordon with the Cyber Center of Excellence and how we are looking at it holistically, not just as nation-to-nation strategic aspect, but the ability to operate tactical, operational, and strategic through all phases of the operations, both setting the theater as well as during combat. That's why we have specifically listed cyber operations as a Army core competency. Because like you said, it's not just on or off, it's there the whole time. So we've got to make sure we have that capability. And I think the Army uniquely looks at it that way. And so now that when you go out to AWA, when you go to NTC, we've got the red team out there from Army Cyber in their nets all the time. So that's why as we take a look, when we talked about the warfighting challenges, we said, hey, one of the things that transcended all of those challenges was reach and back capability. What is one of the challenges? If you have home stations, docking station, how proficient are you on attacking, defending the network, et cetera, like that? If you're going to use your home stations, dock stations all the time, you've got to be proficient on defending your network on and on and on, regardless of what's going on around the world. And so we are putting a big focus on that because we think it is the key to get after our ability to operate over extended lines of communication, et cetera, like that. One of the things our adversaries will use against us, because we operate in a way game over extended lines of communication, is cyber. That is a great way to isolate Army forces and put them in a position of disadvantage. So great question, sir. And we're moving on that to the point where we now call it an Army competency, cyber. And it's not always intuitive. People don't always think that. Other questions? Yes, sir, right here.
Sir, good morning. Tim Hayden, Devil Brigade Combat Team at the 1st Infantry. This question is about the triangle design that we're looking to implement here soon in the ABCTs.
The what?
The triangle design, sir.
Okay.
And is this simply a force structure decision, or is this based upon how we plan to employ the formation in a tactical or strategic setting? And then is it just an iterative move to return back to the Army of Excellence where we had traditional armor and infantry battalions and then task organized for the mission at hand?
Yeah, so we're spending a lot of time thinking through, let me talk about this aspect of task organized. In other words, do we organize, task organize all the time at home station, or do we organize the Army in order to be task organized? And that's what we're trying to figure out. And we haven't actually made any final decisions yet. We're trying to go through some of these first order principles. You saw one of them was to deploy task organized and transition quickly to offensive operations. So what is the best way to do that? Is the best way to do that to be task organized at home station with the assumption that that is how you will deploy and fight that way? Or is it to be, and part of it is generally identifying current problems and how do we solve them? So one of the challenges we've seen as we've come out of Iraq and Afghanistan is some of our skills at the higher end of military operations have atrophied, whether it's logistics, whether it's maintenance, whether it's gunnery, combined arms maneuver, et cetera, like that. So the issue is, how do we solve that? Do we sort of bring together subject matter experts and rebuild that capability, the ability to conduct gunnery, the ability to sustain yourself, the ability to do maintenance, and then retask organize after that? In other words, because if you have limited subject matter experts, you kind of bring them together, get those skills back up to where they used to be, and then when you deploy, task, organize, or do we say, well, let's not reorganize the Army to solve a training problem. Do I just focus more on training? So I'm working actually very closely with General Abrams and the G3. I kind of know where he stands at it, and that's an ongoing discussion. So from your point of view, if that is, since you're out there on the pointy tip of the spear, and I said I wanted feedback, not just electronic feedback, if you have this problem, what is the best way to solve it? If we have those skills of atrophy, from your point of view, is it to organize to solve the problem, training, leader development, what do you think? Thoughts? What's your thoughts on how, what's the best way to solve that problem? Right.
And then how do we make sure that we get our force to the highest degree of readiness to go into the problem set and then rely on our ability to execute mission command and have adaptive, creative, innovative leaders on the battlefield. But it's probably a push in terms of which is better based upon the fact that we don't know the problem set we're going.
Right.
And so that goes back to, is this simply a force design, best business practice decision to reduce the size of the force? Or is there some thought in the notion on how we're going to employ that force on the back?
Yeah, so I will tell you, our focus is not, let's just, you know, spread the peanut butter thinner, et cetera, like that. Our focus is, we've identified the problem, what's the best way to solve it? Now, I mean, we know the Army's going to get smaller, but we, the chief, you saw his priorities there, readiness, et cetera, like that. What we want to make sure is that in those force design principles, you didn't, none of the force design principles were, how do I save spaces? You know, it really is, how do I build capability? So as we're looking at this force design, in that particular case, what we're really looking at is we have a series of skills that have atrophied for all the understandable reasons. What is the best way to rebuild those skills? Now, they atrophied over a period of time for a reason, so do you sort of have to have a shot in the arm? I've had this discussion with the Force Command Commander. Do we have to do something to get those skills back up, whether it's training management, whether it's gunnery maintenance, et cetera, like that, kind of like the old process we used to go through with BTMS or whatever when we first started that, which a lot of the folks here sort of stood up in the Army and get that skill set back to us, and then we transition. I think we're gonna have to go through a series of transitions because we didn't get to where we are in the Army overnight. I don't think we're gonna solve this overnight, but we wanna make sure it's very collaborative with folks like you that we avoid unintended consequences. But to be very clear, we are looking at solving a problem, not designing a force structure to deal with smaller numbers. Okay, great.
Thank you, sir.
Thanks. Other questions? So no one's gonna ask about gender integration.
Sir, I know it's weighing heavily on a lot of maneuver leaders' minds, and you've asked about it twice, so I'll just bite the bullet.
You might
here.
As well, before what is going to happen, right?
Yeah. The Marines recently conducted a study that raised some significant red flags with regards to mobility, accuracy, CASAVAC, just a lot of areas.
Yeah.
How has that affected the Army's integration plan?
Well, I'm glad you asked. So let me just sort of contextualize the environment, so to provide a common visualization of where we are and then what the Army has done and what the way forward is. So back in, I believe, 2013, they removed the combat exclusion rule with regards to women and any combat arms. I think some people don't realize that there is no legal or regulatory prohibition for that. That has been removed. So we aren't at the point of, should we remove the prohibition? It is gone. Legally and regulatorily, there is no prohibition. But when Congress did that, what they said, and therefore Services Secretary of Defense Chairman, you come back to us by the end of this year, so by the end of December, and understand that that prohibition has been removed, so we want to know two things. We want to know, how are you going to do that? How are you going to gender integrate the force? And do you want to request a waiver? Okay, so that's where we are. That first of all, the services have to come back to the Chairman and the Secretary of Defense and say, this is how we're going to do that, number one. By the way, we want a waiver for MOS XYZ. So that's where we are. Do you want to request a waiver? And then, by the way, just come up with your plan. So the Army, like the Army always does, is a very deliberate organization. And so a couple of years ago, an X-Ord was put out with regards to four lines of effort that the Army was going to follow. And they said, here's what we're going to do, and TRADOC owned two of those. They said, the first thing is you need to do a gender integration study. We want you to go out, talk to experts, psychologists, talk to the operating force, veterans, et cetera, like that, and determine what would be some of the impediments to integration with regards to morale, culture, risks out there, et cetera, like that. Do some analysis and come back and say, what are the risks? And then what would be the mitigating capability to do that? And TRADOC was tasked to do that. The second thing is, they said, I want you to go out and conduct a physical demand study. And this is kind of, I think, the open press that you see with regards to what the Marines did. They said, go out and do a physical demand study, and you must come back. They're very specific. By MOS, qualifiable and quantifiable standards for that MOS, and come back and articulate it, et cetera, like that. So those two things TRADOC owned. Third line of effort, the G1 owned was, hey, you need to go out and continue to integrate the part of the Army that's already integrated. What are the policies? And we've done that. We've integrated engineers and, you know, a lot of forces previous to this. And then the fourth one, MedCom owned, which was, hey, go out and take a look at what are the injury issues and medical issues, et cetera, like that. So there are four lines of effort, and TRADOC owned two of them. And so I'll talk about those. I'll talk about where we are as an Army right now. So we went out and did the first one, the gender integration study. That took a couple of years, and we just briefed the secretary and the chief a couple of weeks ago on that. Very extensive study. We went out, and as you would imagine, there were a number of risks highlighted. Sexual harassment, just cultural risk, privacy concerns, on and on. And we went across the force, out to operating units across the Army, went to the Sergeant Major's Academy, had a long discussion with them, other PME venues, senior Army leadership, went to foreign armies that have done this, some of them have done it for decades, et cetera, like that, and came up with a list of risks, and then said, and then here are the mitigating criteria. If you had to do this, our recommendation is you can do this to mitigate from high to medium, from medium to low, et cetera, like that, and went through a whole list of mitigating criteria, and we gave that all to the Secretary and the Chief a couple weeks ago. And oh, by the way, that study won the annual award for the best sort of ORSA work out there, very prestigious study, or very prestigious award with regards to the rigor, depth of analysis, et cetera, like that. So we've done that, the gender integration study, which is really perception and acculturation and effect on morale and all those kind of things. And again, literally an award-winning study, and have a long list of challenges, risk, high, medium, low, and mitigation strategies on how to deal with it. Then the second thing, which tends to get more press, was a physical demand study, and TRADOC ran that as well. And so as this first came up, and as I go around the Army, and I'll talk about sort of the tribe that I come from, infantry armor, I talk to folks, you know, just say, hey, what do you think about women in combat arms and stuff like that? Generally, the first question I get, or the first statement I get all the time, well, I don't know, we'll see, but definitely do not change the standards. I mean, and that brief swallow sounds good. So then my next question is, what is the standard? Everyone says that all the time, don't change the standard. I'm like, hey, I'm all for that. Okay, number one priority, don't change the standard. You saw General Milley's number one priority, readiness. He's very clear to me. We've talked to him about this, readiness. Do not do anything that will reduce the readiness of the United States Army, because we have to provide multiple dilemmas over multiple domains to always be in a position of relative advantage. So we've got to always be ready. So the question is, what are the standards? So what is the standard to be in the infantry or the armor or the artillery right now? What is the standard? Pretty much the standard to be in the Army. You have to pass PT tests and height, weight, and in combat arms be male. I mean, that's the standard. There's really no other standard. Then you got to go through basic AIT, et cetera, like that. We don't have specific standards per MOS. So what we did for over 2 years is we exhaustively went out to all the MOS closed to women and came up with a list of all the operational tasks that you have to do in combat. If you're an infantryman, it's, you know, put on a rucksack, walk X amount of miles. I think it's 110 pounds, 12 miles. Can't remember the length of time. We went to folks in Afghanistan and said, what's your average load? I mean, we had to relate it to a combat requirement. What's your average load? How far do you usually ruck every day, et cetera, like that. For artillerymen, you know, try to find the most demanding physical things, loading ammo, et cetera, like that. For armored crewmen, rate of loading of the main gun, extracting a wounded soldier out of a combat vehicle. Since we designed our combat vehicles for the 90th percentile male, that's a 271-pound male. you have to drag their body 45 feet in 30 seconds. Okay, that's a pretty, we never had that standard anywhere that you had to do that before you could even sign on the dotted line to come in the Army. So we've excruciatingly gone down through all of the physical demands by MOS and related to a wartime task. Because our criteria was it had to be quantifiable, qualifiable, and legally defensible. Because there's already a number of lawsuits right now pending in courts on a number of these things. So we did that very extensively and have a long list of operational requirements by MOS and can relate it to a wartime task and invalidated it, et cetera. Then what we had to do is say, but if we're going to, what we call operational predictive testing, OPAT, if we're going to implement these, would you show up to a recruiting center? We can't have a tank at every recruiting center, although I'm all for it. I think it, draw attention. You know, in a 271-pound person in need and have to pull it out, et cetera, like that. So we've got to develop a test which is a high level of predictive reliability that you could do that operational test in combat. So we got with USARIM and all kinds of physiologists and all kinds of scientists, and we took soldiers and had them do these tests and hooked up monitoring devices, what's their rate of oxygen consumption, put all kinds of meters on them and modeled them, et cetera, like how much weight are you leaving, which part of, which joints get worked harder, et cetera, like that. Very extensive biological tests. And we've come up with a set of predictive tests that we think at a pretty high level of predictability can predict your ability to conduct the operational requirement in combat by MOS. If you're involved in this in industry, you'll know if you're a mathematician that if you have a predictive test and the reliability of the predicted test to reliably predict the ability to do the event, if you're at 0.6, what they call R2 of 0.6, that's an industry standard. We are currently right now at our test at 0.81. Okay, 0.81 reliability of our test, predictability of somebody to do that in combat. Do you know what the current PT test in the Army is right now with regards to reliability of predicting your ability to do those tests in combat? 0.2. Okay, so see, this whole thing we're going after is to increase the readiness of the Army. So we've gone from a 0.2 to a 0.8 with our ability and our testing to predict the reliability to perform those tasks. So we've laid all that out, and we've laid that out to the Chief and the Secretary. And then MedCom has gone through with an exhaustive study with regards to injuries and various things like that, and G1 is coming up with policies on how we would execute that. So that's where we are right now. So TRADOC did those two big studies, gender integration and physical demand study. Gender neutral, okay? We said the task and the MOS, the standard to do it, and the predictability test to get to that. And then the gender integration study was not gender neutral, it was specifically on women in combat arms. And so we've given that data to the chief and the secretary. What they must do now is the chief must give his recommendation, first of all, to the secretary of the Army to go up to the SecDef, as well as to the chairman. And then that will go up to the SecDef as well. And it's all pre-decisional, and they have that information. So that's how we're working through it. So that's a long answer to a short question, but you need to understand that's what the Army has done. This has been a multi-year process, devoid of emotion, trying to have quantifiable and qualifiable data that is legally defensible, and we can relate it to combat requirements. And so now, the chief will get with the Joint Chiefs, the secretary will get SecDef, and we'll work our way forward on that, and then obviously the decisions will be made and we'll execute those decisions. But we do have a huge amount of data at a level of fidelity that we have never had in the Army before, that we have never had. And regardless of what the decision is, I am confident that the information we now have, we are going to be able to leverage it to dramatically increase readiness in the Army. We are going to do a much better job, and Bob Brown will talk about this, on assessments. I'm a big fan of assessing much earlier in sort of the life cycle. As we bring soldiers in the Army, one of the guidance I gave to the folks is I need to have an assessment test that I could do in a recruiting station. That when a soldier walks into a recruiting station, which TRADOC owns Recruiting Command, can an assessment, and we have a five event thing that's at the 0.8 level of reliability. That maybe, because right now, you want to be in infantry, as long as you generally pass sort of legal moral kind of things and GT score and stuff like that, we don't test you before that. I'm a big fan of doing it earlier on. I know Scott's done some great work down here, IPREP. I think we have great insight to increase readiness. When I talk about this, I don't see it as a gender integration study. I see it as the ability to increase readiness and optimize the human dimension of what we do. We can be much better at it. Well, thanks for asking that question. I'll make that an official last question. I would like to end on one note here. And this is to all of us in the audience, the folks that were part of my chain of command that are back here as senior leaders. I know I'm preaching to the choir to you all because you all built what we have today, but specifically to the lieutenants and captains and NCOs out there. So we're going to continue to work on this, and we're going to make a decision on gender integration. And don't worry, we're going to buy something. Hopefully that thing gives us the capability, and we'll have tanks and bayonets and all sleeping bags and all kinds of things in the Army. So don't worry about that. But what I'm saying, don't worry about that, okay? General Miller, General Brown, they get it under control. General Townsend, they'll work this whole thing out. Don't you worry about that. All you leaders out there that are in school right now or that come, you know, plugged in from outside the world, there is one thing that I want you to focus on. We'll get this, the governance thing. We got a great chief. We got a great secretary. We'll make this happen. And that is the essence of what the United States Army is about. I told you the Army operating concept was about the core competency of the United States Army and what capabilities we have. Well, the essence of the United States Army is, last slide, please, the professionalism of the United States Army. And as the chief and the sergeant major of the Army go around, they talk about the Army profession all the time. And don't be misunderstood that the Army profession is some sort of mandatory requirement, 350-1 requirement. It is the essence of being a soldier in the United States Army. Because when I talk about all those things that I want you to do, be able to win in a complex world, in an unknown, constantly changing tactical operations, strategic level world, I can't buy enough things to do that if you are not the quintessential professional out there. And you know who really told me that? Was a senior leader of a different country. So I was a division commander in combat, doing what division commanders do, and working with my counterpart who outranked me quite a bit. And so we were going around doing things and sort of type A American officer, like, you know, hey, sir, we can do this, we can do this, we can do combined arms this, we can do, you know, good idea, on and on. And apparently I did hit the good idea cutoff point with this gentleman. And he finally said, hey, stop, General. He says, you know, I've been watching you command this division. I've been watching you operate. And he says, you know, you take being a general in the United States Army for granted. I said, what? I said, you're questioning the effectiveness of a promotion system that would select somebody like me to be a general officer? Get in line. He goes, no, that's not, you know, sort of questioning your honor there. He says, I watch what you do, and you just get in your fancy helicopter, and you fly up to 1st Brigade, and you tell them to do something, and you leave, and you don't worry that they're going to start a coup. And you go down to 3rd Brigade, and you give them MRAPs, and you don't worry that they're going to sell them on the black market. And you go to the command sergeant major, tell him to do something. He gets all the NCOs together. You don't worry that he's going to call his cousin in the MOD and get you fired, et cetera, like that. And I paused, and I said, you know, you're right. I mean, I don't worry about 1st Brigade starting a coup. I don't worry about 3rd Brigade selling MRAPs. I said, 4th Brigade, I keep my eye on, but, you know, I got reasons. What he was saying is, Perkins, I see you operate, and you're so naive. You just trust everybody. You just trust all the soldiers you're in division and your non-commissioned officers that they're going to do what you tell them to do. He said, I can't operate like that. He says, you know, if you were in my army, we'd eat you for lunch every day. You know, so you have all these great ideas, Perkins. That's great if you have an army like that. And oh, by the way, Perkins, you know what? Your unit seems to be sort of self-policing. That when a sergeant isn't doing something right, a sergeant first class, his platoon sergeant comes in and helps him out. Or if a lieutenant's out of line, a captain comes in and squares him away. It's always self-correcting. Your division's spread all over the place, and I drive around, and I see your folks doing all kinds of things on their own, and you're not even there. In fact, Perkins, I'm not really sure what you do. I mean, you're not really that good, because this stuff ceases to be going around without you even there. And when I talk to your soldiers, they tend to have a sense of something larger than themselves. They do what they do not for themselves. They do it for the honor of the unit and everybody else. They don't want to let down the person to the left and right. It has nothing to do with their cousin being the MOD. That's not why they do it. They do it because of the other folks in the squad and the platoon and the company. They're not about to let their unit down. And oh, by the way, your folks really seem to know what they're doing. You know, I was watching this artillery unit. They were doing counterinsurgency one day, and the next day, they're firing artillery howitzers for combined arms live fire with dismounted troops. So one day, they're doing counterinsurgency, okay, deploying elements of national power. The next day, they're firing howitzers. I don't even think there was an officer in the group. There's a bunch of non-commissioned officers transitioned just like that. So he says, Perkins, don't you lecture me about you want to do this and this and this and this, because you know what? You're not that good. You have a problem, Perkins. You can't operate unless you have one of these. You have a crutch. You lean on this every day. I just watch the way you operate. You just lean on people. You trust them. You lean on non-commissioned officers to be stewards of the profession. You lean on the officers to know what they're doing. And he said, the other thing is, where do you get your soldiers? He says, you have soldiers that travel thousands of miles from home to give their lives for people they don't even know, and I can't even get my soldiers to defend their own country. He says, don't you lecture me about you want to do this and that, because he says, you couldn't do anything, Perkins, unless you had one of these. You have a real weakness there, General. You are addicted to this profession. In other words, you couldn't survive a day unless you had an army like this. You know what? He was absolutely right. He was absolutely right. I could not survive a day as a division commander unless I had one of these. And the thing is, you know, he said, it's almost like this is a whole bait and switch thing. Like, you Americans came over here and we bought your tanks, we got your Humvees, we got your rifles, and they don't do anything. They just sit there and rust and nothing happens. You know why? Because we didn't buy this. It's not for sale on FMS. You know, you're right. It's not for sale. Because you know where you get this? You build it yourself. Okay, it's homemade. We build it inside the Army. And that's what you all are. You guys are building, guys and gals and DA civilians, everyone, we're building this each and every day. You know, 14 June of this year, we celebrated 240 years of the Army serving our nation, the Army birthday. Army birthday is 14 June, 1775. The birthday of our nation is 4 July, 1776. The United States Army is 1 year older than the United States of America. The organization that you leaders, we are entrusting you with, is 1 year older than the nation you defend. And the only thing we can really bank on in the future is not the Army operating concept, it's not a functional concept, it's not the Army warfighting assessment, it's this. It's this right here. And like I was telling that general, it's not for sale because it took us 240 years to build it. 240 years to build it. With a lot of blood, sweat, and tears, like General Milley talked about, and these great Americans here that have served, took a long time to build this. You know how he built it? Soldier by soldier, sergeant by sergeant, lieutenant by lieutenant for 240 years. And do you know how you lose it? Soldier by soldier, sergeant by sergeant, lieutenant by lieutenant. Took 240 years to build, you can lose it like that. And do you know who knows that? Everybody that works with the American Army. It does not take them long to say, you know what, really the strength of you all is that. And as you all work, he looks at leaders of the American Army, we rely on this every day. We take it for granted. And you know what? I don't plan on taking it for granted. I don't plan on taking you for granted. Thanks for your service, and Scott, thanks for letting me have time here today. Hua.
Ladies and gentlemen, if you can be back in your seats by 10 after 11. I'm sorry, 10 after 10. 10 after 10.